What is art? Is there a common thread connecting all art forms? Arts Thread, an East Carolina University production.
Hello, this is Arts Thread, and I'm your host, Jessica Honesty. Our purpose is to get a better understanding of talented artists and their art forms. We have joining us today Rudy Chu, an assistant professor in communications in the media production concentration. How are you doing today, Mr. Chu?
Thank you for having me here.
Thank you for coming. Okay, so film combines so many different elements. What makes film production an art form, and what makes the film so unique?
Okay, well, compared to the other art forms, filmmaking, actually cinema, it's a very young one. And obviously we borrow a lot of things from all kinds of art forms. We borrow narrative from literature, image, aesthetics from sculpture, and also paintings, for instance, and also the control of rhythm and all that from maybe music. The difference is like this. For instance, if you're playing a piano, the pianist, of course, has to control the pacing of that whole piece. He has to emphasize a couple notes here and there, right? To work out a really passable pacing for that whole piece. But not until he record the sound, then edit it maybe later in post-production, then you can really play with time here, right? But in film, however, if you are shooting a shot for 8 minutes long, then that 8 minutes of time before the after the director say action and before he say, after he say cut, then the 8 minutes imprinted in that piece of film. And then we manipulate directly on the time. So that's the cool thing about filmmaking.
All right, well, now we're going to take a look at a scene from one of the clips that, or one of the pieces that you directed.
Right.
So, real clip.
Thank you.
It's hard to have an image and allow everyone to see it. And in your own vision, in the scene, you were able to bring that to life. What is it about the scene that illustrates properties of an art form?
Yeah, as I said, film is actually dealing with time and memory, all that. So in this particular sequence, we just called it dream sequence in my production, because this is one of the key things. And my story is a little bit complicated. Well, it's also surreal. I like to work with surreal elements here. And this is about a loser. I always do make films for losers, but when you show it to the real loser, they don't really understand it. But anyway, so the thing is like this, a 40-year-old, 50-year-old guy, you know, finally at the end, near the end of his middle age, he started to realize he didn't do nothing, accomplish anything in his life. So he wants to blame something, to blame somebody for it. And during that process, he's working on a novel or something. He's a writer, not that successful writer. And he's trying to find the cause for all the failure in his life. And by doing that, he actually formed a really small world. Only he can live in it. And he's being there isolated and all that. So he's driving everybody away. He lost his best friend and his parents and also his wife. That's the most important character in his life, person in his life. And now it's time, the second half of that film is now it's the time to find out how you can fix it. And he blamed a cat for it. Because in his memory, he remembered that the cat came to him when he was only 17 years old. And the cat promised him that I'll make you a good writer and all that as long as you let me to be your host, that kind of stuff. Yeah, it's a little bit surreal and yeah. And of course, he blamed the cat for it. Now it's the time to find that cat. He wants to get that back. He wants to get his happiness back. But of course, I do have a happy ending actually, but I just dumped it. Yeah, it's not truthful to the story, so I dumped it. And this particular dream sequence is when he finally figured out what really went wrong. Even though I tried to do it in a very abstract form, you know, playing with time, camera angles, camera movements, and all that, and also especially color, attended to blue and all that. So, right.
I remember in the footage, there's a scene when the male, he's looking outside of the window, the female's looking in the mirror, and then she comes and looks outside of the window, and he's outside. And she's also, you know, screaming or whatnot. Is that him leaving her?
Right. He's looking back to his life and realizing that's what he did to her, right? And even though she said, don't go, but he chose to go. That was a really tricky scene, a really tricky shot actually, because the whole scene is just one single shot, lasts maybe 4 minutes or so, a little bit less than 4 minutes. We rehearsed all day until I think it's all right. The timing is perfect for everybody. We have five or six actors. They all have to hit the precise marks at a precise time moment. So directing that scene, I really learned a lot because the camera is also moving, and then how do you block the actors and without showing them really moving in the shot. So they are, you know, wandering around, try to get it. And that particular moment when the wife blocks the mirror, I try to figure out how to do that even in, I spent probably 15 hours or so trying to figure that out. I was dumb. And finally, I figured out the wife can block the window and the guy can, the male actor can actually jump off the window. Remember, we're shooting this on a real set. It's not a, you know, it's my bedroom. So, and he refused to do it. He refused because the window was like really high, 50 feet or so. So I have to jump myself, tried it several times to make sure it's safe. And then he has to jump it off the window, and then she has to block the mirror. And then when the camera follow her and comes back to the window, that's when he has to hit that mark. And then so we did 13 takes, I believe, and we succeeded three takes. And this is the best one of them, so I decided to use it. And when you cut to outdoor, I was lucky that day in Durham, North Carolina, it snowed. We were going to shoot outside, actually. And then I said, okay, scratch that. Let's just use that snow. So that's the whole second half of that scene. It's Cat's point of view, how he turns into a cat. Since you cannot really show that, so I'm using his point of view, bringing it down, and then it becomes snow scene. And snow, of course, is death. Once you give yourself up to something, then you're dead, in my book, that is. So this is how he realized the whole thing about his life, and now he's going to save himself, right? And I'm not gonna give it away, but at the end of the film, he didn't give himself up, right? And he basically destroyed that small world of his and comes out of it, right? So that's the real, I think that's the truthful ending to the project. So
I thought it was very interesting all of a sudden, you know, he was in the house and then he's outside, so.
I must say this, those are just technical things. Uh-huh. And technical things, once you have experience, this is what I talk to my young friends here. Technical things are just really kids play. What's behind it, that's what really matters, right? You have to have a philosophy. You got to see your life in a way that you know what you're doing, okay? And you have to have a vision there. And the most important thing is you have to stay truthful to yourself. I tried to do that with this film. This was actually my thesis film. It's a feature, and all my professors were like, you know, don't do this. You will, you know, you just forget about your MFA now, right? Because it's going to take too long. But I decided to go along and all that. And, you know, the whole family suffered with me. I sold a house for this film and all that. But at the end, I couldn't figure out my ending, really. As I said, I have a couple endings, and I shot them already. None of them worked. So for 6 months or so, I tried to figure out that ending. That was the most desperating, you know, it's just very depressed time for me. So I finally figured that out, and then I think now it works. So I just tell my young friends here, you got to stick to it. There's no other way to do it. You got to be truthful.
Right? Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, another question. Mm-hmm. How do you differentiate between art and entertainment, and what makes the pieces you work on art?
Okay. To me, it's a matter of time. For instance, if you use Mozart's music, all right. Uh-huh. Back then, when he did Magic Flute. Okay. The crowd saw it as amusement, right? It's not really art, but now you see it. Now it's art. So it really takes time to really understand what's going on there. And back then, in Mozart's time, artist, this is not a concept. Not until say Beethoven, probably, he started to call himself as an artist. So I think whenever I watch a so-called entertaining film, I always pay attention on how the director did, how the filmmaker did it. What's the technical things that he did differently from, you know, somebody else? Mm-hmm. That's the places I'll be focusing on. So that film can be entertaining, maybe at a different level or something. And always, always, the so-called art films, they are always entertaining. So to me, it's a very difficult question to answer, because I don't really see much of a difference there, right?
All right. Tell us all, please. What inspired you to put so much work into the process of making films?
Okay. I want to be a filmmaker since I was probably 14 or so, and my dad was a literature professor in my country, really well respected and all that. And he was a chair for several film festivals back then, but he wouldn't let me to go to a film school because he thought the lifestyle was immoral almost, right? So a Chinese father, you know that. So so I actually lied to my family when I came here after my military service in Taiwan. I came here to, I told them I'm getting a PhD in literature. But I checked myself into a film school instead. And so I got an MFA instead of PhD, and I never regret for a second. This is what I really want to do. I grew up, like probably a lot of you guys here, watching Zhang Wen, you know, and a lot of some Asian films and tons of European films. And my favorite director, I can really say my favorite, because there are so many, they are so good. But the one that I really admire the most is still Andrei Tarkovsky, a Russian filmmaker, only did maybe 7 features in his life. You know, he got a book called Sculpting Time. I recommend that book to everybody, whoever is serious in this. There was a chapter, and there was a chapter he mentioned about his why he's making this film. And he said it really, really cleverly and clearly. Whenever I read about that chapter, sometimes it will bring tears to my eyes. He said, nobody can really force this tax on you. And the filmmaking is actually sometimes humanly impossible, all right? So if you want to do that, it's all or nothing. And that's my philosophy for in terms of filmmaking. It's either all or nothing. You have to go for the all, right? So you have to put whatever you have into it. If you don't do that, then you could not really call yourself a filmmaker, right? So I'll say Tarkovsky is my hero there, right?
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's all or nothing. Right. Mr. Chu, thank you so much for coming on
thank
the set today.
Thank you for having me.
All right, this is Arch Thread. I'm your host, Jessica Honesty. Thank you for tuning in.